Welcome everyone to the last session of 2020 for Power Platform Finance, which is scenario modeling in Power Query with Imke Feldman. So just in case you are brand new to the PPF community, it's a community where we're taking for finance and IT professionals for looking at how to leverage the full Power Platform within the finance area. So said it's a really interesting area. We think there's lots of scope and potential for Power BI and also for the other Power Platform tools to leverage in this space. So it's really an application of these tools to finance. We've been running it this is the 17th webinar that we're running this year. So we've been running them fortnightly since Easter. And next year we'll be looking to do webinars as well, but also some more kind of hands-on exercises and things like that. So stay tuned on that. Myself, I'm Rishi, so I'm a chartered accountant by background, but I work at Altius or Avanade now as a principal consultant, looking at self-serve analytics and focusing on Power BI and looking at how to implement that in enterprises. And Chris, do you want to give a quick intro?
Hey everyone, I'm also Altius. I'm a consultant as well, and working on a number of different clients, and I'm a chartered accountant by background as well, hence the involvement with the finance aspect. And Naveen, do you want to say hello as well?
Yeah, I'm helping out Rishi and Chris with the PPF, I know Rishi from our network, and we started another project, Learn Data Insights. It's another one which you might want to visit sometime. So thank you, Imke, for coming. Hope you are doing well, and look forward to watching this session. Thank you.
Cool. And Kyle, do you want to say hello as well? See this, your name's going to be on here soon.
Sure, why not? My name isn't up there yet, but it will be soon. My name is Kyle Mueller.
Slides together 5 minutes ago, so I haven't changed any slides.
Perfect. So, hey everyone, my name is Kyle Mueller. I am a data impact architect and the head of our data analytics practice at Envision Technology Advisors, joining from Rhode Island in the US.
Oh, great.
Hi, Kyle.
So, just what's new on the platform. So say this is the 17th webinar. The last one was with Mark Wilcock a fortnight ago. It was really interesting. He was looking at how to do nearest neighbors, which is kind of a statistical method traditionally, but looking at how to do that in Power BI using many-to-many relationships and looking at some of the challenges with many-to-many. So things like model ambiguity and then how you can get around that by using inactive relationships or tree tasks and things like that. So some really interesting modeling challenges which are very applicable in the finance space. So if you haven't watched that yet or you want to rewatch it, then check it out on the YouTube channel. So the link's there on the site, or just type in Learn Data Insights into YouTube. That's the channel where we've hosted all the PPF videos. If you could please give feedback. I know quite a few have already. It is really helpful. And Chris, Naveen, and Carl and I will be going through this again as well in a week or two and kind of go through, look, use this feedback to shape what we do with PPF next year and the topics that we put and things like that. So especially if you've got ideas for topics or you want to present one yourself, please do fill this out, or please feel free to reach out to any of us and let us know. That was it. So we haven't got the slide for next week, but we've got Sandeep on the call actually, and I think potentially he's going to do one in January. Sandeep, are you there? Okay, maybe I'll mute. Oh, hi there. I think Sandeep, you were talking about potentially doing something for looking at Python, right? Integration.
Correct. Yes.
Hopefully we'll get something like that set up. As soon as we get some details firmed up, I'll post it on the website. As I say, for next year as well, we're also looking at how we can do something a bit different as well and make this more interactive and more of a two-way thing. So as much as webinars are great, there's a lot of them, there's a lot of content, a lot of people watching stuff on the screen. I think we want to try and build in some more interactivity and two-way engagement. So look out for that next year. And again, obviously, any ideas, any ideas or content, or if you want to present anything, please do let us know. Right, okay, so I think now over to Imke. Do you want to share your screen?
Yes, thank you very much.
Great.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, I can see it.
Excellent. So, hello everybody, and thanks for the invitation. for today. Today, I'm going to talk about scenario modeling in Power Query. But first, let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Imke Feldmann, and I'm running the blog thebiaccountant.com, which some of you might know already. I'm a big fan of the M language and Power Query. So you find a lot of stuff related to these topics on my blog. For a living, I'm working as a freelance Power BI consultant since a couple of years. And before that, I have worked for about 15 years in finance as a finance director, controller, before head of accounting. So several different positions in the finance world. And now I moved over to the technical side, basically, to implement all the cool new tools that Microsoft came up with. And what I want to show today is some simple exercise where I want to show you how you can apply typical finance modeling use cases with the new tool Power Query in Power BI, basically. And I'm going to start with a use case where I want to, I'm considering creating some calendars for a year. And I've collected some figures, costs, and potential sales, for example. In this table, you see here, there are the costs that are fixed, that are my fixed costs that will occur independent on the versions of on the different versions of calendars I'm going to produce. And in a second table, I have scenarios or different versions. I have the option to produce a premium version of my calendar that has a higher price than the standard version. Therefore, I'm expecting to sell a bit less and have to adjust the print run for some excess quantities. I have offers for printing. The first offer is £8, actually, and the second offer is €7. And if I'm gonna take the premium version, there will additionally be some fixed costs with the printing setup, and I'm gonna have to invest more for editorial costs if I'm going to produce my premium version. And also I have some scrapping costs because of some special ingredients in my in the production process that I cannot scrape it for free. So this is my basic data that I have to I want to compare. And what I can do in Power BI is to come up with some sort of sensitivity analysis. Here, for example, we see some variations on sold quantities and how they affect my net profit of either the premium version or the standard version. So these are, I think, basic analysis that you usually do in Excel as well. And then I can also show some extended sensitivity analysis based on certain scenarios that I have defined in my Excel table. My first scenario is that I have price variations in 0.1 steps from minus 0.2 to plus 0.2. My second case has variations in three of my drivers. And my last case only has variations in two of my drivers. And just by defining possible cases in a table like that, I could go on and on and on and define other intervals and cases combination. Based on that, I can then see all the possible outcomes in a nice matrix here, where I can have basically have a full flexible view of all possible combinations that are included in my scenario options. So I can get a feeling for which scenarios will be profitable or where I'm running risk to lose money, for example. And a third typical use case in financial modeling is to single out the effect on the result of each potential driver of my results. Here, for example, I have variations of 5% that I've defined in my table like so for the tornado chart. And there it gives me a ranking of the cost or the drivers that have the biggest impact or the smallest impact on my overall result. And last but not least, I can also try to incorporate the effect of uncertainty. So if I would have likelihoods of certain events to occur, so no one knows what the future exactly holds for us, so I can then just model some certain factors and apply certain distributions of possible outcomes to them, and then create possible outcomes, do statistical analysis on them, for example, calculate confidence level and visualize the outcomes graphically like here, so that we can see where our, with 5 plus minus confidence variation or 95 confidence level, our boundaries of the most likely outcomes would lie, for example. Here in this example, to the left side, we see a Monte Carlo analysis that is based on a normal distribution curve. And to the right, we see a simulation that is based on the actual development of the currency rates. So what I did here is to get the currency rates from British pounds to euro from the last 2 or 3 years, I believe. And based on the actual distribution in there, I'm applying this distribution that we've seen so far, which seems to be a bit to the left compared to a normal distribution. I'm applying this distribution instead to my data. And what you see here is the Monte Carlo result from just 100 runs, so 100 different events that have been allocated according to the predefined distribution curves. And here we see that we have quite some gaps in our confidence levels. And if I now added my parameters to do a 10,000 events Monte Carlo simulation and click OK. I have to refresh my data. And then all the calculation that takes the currency rate as a variable and applies all the calculations to it will be calculated. You see that's fairly fast. And then you see that our confidence intervals, they really narrowed down. And with 10,000 runs, here we see that the bell curve is forming more clearly. And here we see that we are using a different distribution, which is actually mirroring the distribution of the actual currency rates in the past period. And so this is, most of it is basically all done by Power Query. And I thought I'd just walk you through how to do it. Has this been understandable so far? Can you follow me or are there questions so far? Yeah. So what I have here in my Power Query is a list of functions that I have prepared. They are shown here as a record, but behind that is nothing but a lot of M code that is shaped in a form that it can readily be consumed in my analysis here. I have my British pound, historical British pound rates. I'm using this. Here's my parameter for the Monte Carlo count that I've just adjusted. Here is some currency rate for a point in time that I'm used in my first calculations. And so what we do is we first import the Excel file that I've just shown and work out some tables from it. Here is our estimates of the costs that are independent from the scenarios. Here we have the estimates that are dependent on the versions, either premium or standard. I'm going to unpivot them. And then I've also displayed the sensitivity tables where we have all our scenarios or cases. And then I have a master data table to select the tables and for them to be understandable once they are displayed. And here's just a table for the data model that lets me switch between premium and standard. And what I usually start with is that I take my scenario table and reshape it a bit to come up with the proper position for working out my possible profit. So I do some unpivoting and then I have my cost, my scenarios, premium and standard, in a form where every scenario is one row and all items for each scenario will sit in a certain column here. And I'm gonna then add the estimates that are not dependent on the version, these three elements that are also going to be added and expanded. So now I have all information there is for each scenario as a starting table. And from there, I'm going to add my currency at a certain point in time. So here I have British pounds and euro with one expanded. And this is something that we're gonna transform to a variable later on to run the, let the Monte Carlo analysis apply different currency rates and come up with the results. But first of all, I have to calculate my actual sales. Here you see that I have I reference the column price in euro and multiply it by my sales quantity. And these are basically very simple and straightforward simple calculations. We are just apply the calculation logic to come up with the actual full euro values. And at the end, I should see the prospected net profit that would occur if I choose one or the other version. And the next step is that for my first what I can then do is to transform this this query here into a function, because later on I want to have the currencies as optional drivers. And to do that, I just implement two function parameters. One is the scenario table that is just referenced here in the source step. And the second one is the currency table that we've referenced Where did I reference my currency table? Should be in here somewhere. Sorry about that. I'm referencing it here. Here, I'm sorry, just in the first step, I'm just joining with the currency table and grab the corresponding values to them.
So Imke, is that coming from a web query, the exchange rates, or is that? Mm-hmm. Is that coming
Yes, this is my currency rates here. It's just a function, the function GBP rate that sits in my function report here. And if you see, check out the function definition, this one here, you see that I'm grabbing it from the Yahoo Finance API.
Yeah.
This is fairly fast.
Yeah, I think we need to get you back to do a session on functions in M as well. Doing things like this, that's a session by itself, but it's really useful.
I think so, yes. For our first visual, actually, that's basically it, what we had so far already. We just have two scenarios with possible outcomes. But the next steps are getting more interesting. So here, here is the mechanism to derive the sensitivity intervals. So I'm gonna just divided by 20 because I can create a list just bigger intervals. And in the second step, I just do some renamings. And what I do is I'm gonna add the sensitivity intervals to each scenario and expand it. And then I'm gonna apply this as a variance to my sold quantities. To my sold quantities. Here you see that the sensitivity column is multiplied by the sold quantities. And then I'm have my new, these are the variations that result from the sensitivities, and then I'm just gonna add them to my to the original quantities that I had planned. And in the next step, I then use my transformations that effectively then calculate the net profit as a function. Here you see that I'm gonna apply the transformation function that comes up with the net profit on the scenarios, on the scenario table, and just select the columns I finally need, which is the sensitivity interval, my net profit, and the version, the original version I had. And in the last step, based on that, I can basically apply the sensitivity analysis. That is a separate function. Maybe if we have some time later on, I can go into the details here. But here I built out all the possible combinations that I have defined in my sensitivity table. So these are just the variations to my quantity, and all the other variations that I want to apply, plus minus variations on price, on shipping, print run, and so on. All the variations that derive from this table will then be dynamically applied by the sensitivity function that sits in my function wrapper up here. And now I have my columns of the variations of each cost driver that has been part of my scenarios that I need to create this table, this matrix here. So these four columns, intervals, these four columns sit in my matrix, so two on each rows and columns. And if I want to, I can also drill up and drill down, but usually, I mean, with an analysis like this, I want to see it all in one table. And because we have everything in one big table here, with not only all the four columns that you see here, but also the names for the cases and also whether it's premium or not, I can then simply slice and dice my scenarios and see what the possible outcomes of all these different combinations are. And compared to that, actually the tornado analysis is fairly simple. I start again with my estimates here. And filter on my tornado values, boil it down a bit, and then I'm going to duplicate the drivers and build out the structure for this mirrored display that we see here. And I define my increment values and again use the sensitivity function on it, reuse it basically to come up with the elements for my visual axis. I have the variations in price, possible variations in quantity, and the variations in printing costs. These are my factors here. And for example, if I say, well, I want to adjust the print run as well, but here I actually want to see how it would perform if I make a 10% variation on that. I'm gonna save. I have to save my file first before I go back and click on refresh. And here you see I now have an additional column. Actually, it's this one. This has been added, print run dynamically. And we should then, once we've loaded it into the data model, we should then see it in there as well. There's some other cleanup that I have to do to boil it down to the figures that are actually needed in the visual. Here I define whether it's on the up or on the down side, but that's really not nothing really spectacular in here. And again, here you see, I'm just working out my net profit here, and again, that's my basic net profit. That's the variations on net profit that have been occurred through the ups and downs that we see here. And at the end, this is the shape that I need to work out the tornado charts. And if I refresh the table now, we should then see four tornado elements instead of three. It's there, but it's not showing. Let's see what. So here you see that we have some results for our print runs, but for some reasons they are not shown. Okay, that's the demo god. Sorry about that. I'm going to figure that out later, I think. Sorry about that. So in the last demo, I want to show you how to, or otherwise, are there questions so far before I move over to the Monte Carlo analysis?
So yeah, there's a couple of questions just on the, actually, are you able to show a little bit about how you do the functions as a reference library?
Yes.
That'd be really interesting, thanks.
Yes, of course, whatever you want. So how I come up with this, how I created this?
Yeah.
Okay. So assume you have or let me start, if you're interested in functions, maybe we can start from scratch. So here we have a query where we say we want to use this query, but with different currency values. This is a table here, and so we want to make this as a variable, and also we want to also make the original table that we are applying it on also as a variable. So what you can do to easily create a function out of this query is to create parameters for the values that shall become variables. And this is my first parameter. I call it scenario, and I disable the required field, and then I'm going to choose the type for the value actually. So here we know that this is going to be a table. And if we want to select a table here in our parameters, we see that there is no table. So there's no dropdown that lets you choose a table for a parameter. So what we do instead, we leave it on any, which is basically no type, click OK. And then this parameter has been created down here. We go into the advanced editor. And here, instead of any, I type in table. So this is my way of converting it to a table instead. And for the second parameter, that's going to be our currency table here, I also create a parameter that I call currency, and I'm also gonna tweak it a bit as table. And now the next step, let me just duplicate this query before I potentially destroy it. As the next step, I'm gonna replace the references to the actual tables here by reference to the parameter instead. Therefore, I cut out the reference to the actual table and replace it by a reference to the parameter. And now it returns null. And I will get errors for the subsequent steps because I haven't allocated any value to my parameter so far. And to do that, here you see the null that we've seen before. To do that, I paste the cutted reference to the original table in here. So my scenario one is actually a table that now sits in the parameter instead, like it said before, here as a direct reference. So now we have an indirect reference. Before that, it was scenario one. Now it's called scenario, just scenario, which is actually a parameter. And this parameter holds a table. It doesn't show us here because there's just no functionality for it. But if you go into the advanced editor, you see that the table scenario actually is the content of our parameter. And just the same we're going to do with the currencies. So I'm going to cut out currencies, which was the a table, replace it with the name of my parameter. That's now the name of my parameter, which gives me an error because null cannot be converted to table. Therefore, I have to go to my currency parameter and replace null reference to my actual currencies table, like so. Now my query is working again. It's still a query, but it's working and it has references to parameters instead of actual tables. And now I can right click and let it create a function. The function name is my new function, like so. And this should usually have so here you see that this is my old query you see here, and this is now the function that has been derived from it. And if I want to add this function to my function record here above, I'm gonna go to the advanced editor, and in this case actually let me do another thing. I don't want to destroy this special functionality that I will explain in a minute. I just copy this, I duplicate this function, and from the duplicated function I go to advanced editor. I do it differently. Let me check this. I just right click here, go copy, and with the copied function I go to my function record, go to the advanced editor, go scroll down here and add my new function to the record. Therefore, I go to the end of the last function, make a comma, and now if I paste what I've copied, it should also give me the function name. Here you see the function name, new function number two, has actually been copied with it. That's why I didn't copy it from the advanced editor. I just uncommented these two slashes is a comment, and say, well, my fn new function shall be this M code that came with it. And by doing so, I now have my new function included in my function report. And if I didn't have this report existing in the first instance, but this would have been my first function in my workbook, I could also create this record from scratch. by going to just creating a blank query and define a record. So a record is defined by square brackets. And the first element is the record field name. And then I'm going to allocate or assign a value to it with the equal sign. And I say hello, like so. Returns return a record. Okay. This is what the record looks like. Record field name here, record field name, and the value hello. And I can also add another field, a field with a function. And there I just write a function in it. So this is a function without a parameter, but it's still a function. Function. So there you see that now I have a record with two fields in it. One has a simple text in it, and one has a text that is encapsulated in a function. So if I would, I can then just reference this function query, this record. And if I look up the first field, the lookup is also done with square brackets, record field name. If I look up this field, I get hello. And if I look up the function instead, a field with a function, I get a function. But if I invoke it like so, I then get the text. So this is basically the whole mechanism behind it. You define record with M code. So if I go to the advanced editor here, it's basically no different to what you see in my original function record, just that I only have functions in here and they have a bit more code than the other ones. But apart from that, it's just a bit of M code that holds some useful functions for later reference. Any questions for this?
So I guess Jeremy is asking why create a function? Why not just make a parameter without a function? What's the advantage of doing it as a function?
Okay, so I need to create my query. Or repeat the question, please. I'm not sure if I understood the question correctly.
Jeremy, do you want to come off mute and ask it yourself, maybe?
Okay, thanks. Well, thanks, MK. This is now I'm learning more about functions and parameters. But earlier you made a parameter and then you made a function pointing to that parameter. I'm just wondering why you made. I guess I don't understand functions and parameters that well. That why you made a function that maybe pointed to a parameter.
Okay.
Or why you made the function when you had the parameter.
Okay, so what we have here is a query that calculates net profit for one business case or for two business cases. Two business cases for my premium version and for my standard version. But these business cases work with the currency rate at a point of time. And in order to make scenario or sensitivity analysis to say, well, I don't want to see this one, but I want to see different values here, I have to create a function to replace these fixed values by a number of different other values. So that's basically the reason for converting a query into a function. And there are different ways to do it. I could have just created the function with code like so, scenario, no parameter, currency, no parameter. And for this to work, I have to replace the references like so here. So now I have a function with function parameters that don't are real parameters in my Power BI workbook anywhere. The reason why I created these real parameters with a bit of coding, because there's no native functionality for it, is the convenient mechanism that sits in the way I created it. If I want to, here you see, this is the function that has automatically been created by using this create function mechanism. And if I want to check the code, I get a warning that if I continue to edit this function in the advanced editor, I cannot use this query anymore. The really convenient effect of doing what I did is that every change that I make to the query here, let's say I want to add another column, custom column, net profit, just some stupid stuff, net profit times two. Every change that I make to my original query may be another step or an error that I've detected will automatically be reflected in this function. And this is quite convenient, especially if you're making scenarios analysis like that. And as you go, you recognize, well, I got a new offer that has some new additional fields that I want to incorporate here. By doing so, I can conveniently edit my query, change it, make adjustments. And the function that I'm using in the other queries so far that work with it doesn't have to be adjusted manually. So this is the only way to create functions via this special parameter method here. Otherwise, you could just use code to create a function. But then if you want to debug it or adjust it, it's a bit inconvenient, because you have to then comment out the function definition and create real table references or value references to the values from your parameters. Has this been understandable?
Yeah, I think that's really handy. Can you just very quickly explain as well how that's different to dynamic M parameters? Because I know there's, you know, there for to enable query folding against like Christo and things like that. So there's a new dynamic M parameters. Have you explored that much as well?
No.
Okay. No, that's fine.
That's a completely different
thing, right? So that's what I was saying in the chat as well. It's really for essentially for enabling query folding against indirect query, maybe against sources in a more flexible way. But it's not to do this kind of thing. I think have you tried doing this kind of thing as well in DAX and tables rather than all in Power Query, and do you think it would be challenging to do it in DAX?
I mean, it's basically I prefer Power Query. I know a couple of people do things in DAX as well, but the problem is once I am in DAX, there's no way back if I need recursion. So as you might know, Power Query has no limits in what it can calculate, but there are just technical limits in what DAX can do. And once you are in DAX, there's no way back to do certain things that need recursion, for example, to go back to Power Query. So it's just that I'm exploring basically the boundaries of doing things with Power Query here, because I love the language, and I just want to be have my options open. So I don't want to end up in a dead end, basically, when I see that I end up with things that where DAX isn't capable of doing.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I actually saw they introduced recursion into Excel with the Lambda function. I don't know if you saw that. Recently. That looks really interesting as well.
Really, Excel really made some really big steps forward lately. Very nice new additions here. But the point is, I mean, these are calculations that are often be done in Excel, but my point is that I think that doing it in Power Query, for example, is much more stable, and you have much less risk in messing up your values doing it in Power Query, for example. You have a nice separation of data and formulas, for example, unlike Excel, where it's just easy to overwrite things or mess up your data. So I think that's doing it in Power Query is really much more secure and controlled than in Excel.
Yeah, agreed. So it's interesting to see the governance challenges that will come of trying to audit an Excel model with recursion and stuff like that going on inside formulas. That will be an interesting challenge. Okay, so I think the Monte Carlo thing, I think maybe we'll leave to the next session, if that's all right.
Okay.
We've covered a lot here, and I think this will be really useful. Are you able to share this PBIX file with people?
Yes, of course. Yes.
Yep. If you send it through to me, I'll put it up on the PPF site. I'll include the link in the video, and I'll go through this as well, and I'll add some annotations as to kind of what's going on. So which is what I do to understand it better as well, and hopefully that will help. That will help other people. As we go through that, are there any kind of final questions? Actually, Amir is asking about if you do trainings, kind of I suppose virtual trainings. Where do you do them? What format do you do them in? When?
I don't offer formal trainings. I mostly do development, to be honest.
Okay, sure.
I do coaching, so I do development for my customers, and I do trainings for them, or coach them in certain things. But I don't have run open trainings. So, if you have special aspects that you want to discuss, feel free, but there are so many standard Power Query trainings out there that I'm not in this
Yeah, no, sure. Sorry. And if you have any specific things that you want to know, you know, let me know as well. And what we can always do is try and build an example around it, a specific use case and a specific maybe worked example, and maybe bring that into PPF for one of the sessions that we do hands-on next year as well. So I think some of this stuff will be really good to do hands-on. Even it'd be much smaller scale, obviously. We won't be able to cover all of the material that you've covered today in a hands-on, but I think that would be a really good way for people to grasp it. So yeah, that if you're open to that, that'll be great for next year.
Yeah, of course.
Any other questions, Emka, before we back up? We've got a lot of thank yous, feeling dunks in the chat.
Thank you so much.
So I'm just having a quick scroll up to see if I've missed anything. If I've missed any questions. Chris, I don't know if you've seen anything, or Naveen, if anyone wants to unmute at this point, if there's anything that I've missed in terms of questions, I'll take that as a no. Okay. It's a very humbling webinar. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if it's for people who work in Power Query every day, we don't use it to the same level, I think, that you do, which is really good, because actually one of the main things you want to do with Power Query is make it maintainable, repeatable, and kind of transparent. And, you know, it can very easily get quite unwieldy. So doing things like having your functions in a library and you know, referencing queries and using parameters and, you know, functionizing as much as you can, I think are really, really good approaches. I think it's just getting people used to working like this in a way that could be repeatable.
Yes, of course. I mean, it's different work compared to Excel, of course. But yeah, the point is that you have your models. You can modularize a lot of logic, pack it into custom functions, and hopefully Microsoft will come up with a more convenient way that that we can reuse functions. For example, in Power BI, I could have used a custom connector for it, but I cannot use a custom connector in Excel. So what I can do here is, if I say, well, that's cool and stuff, but I want to actually work with these figures in Excel as well, I just could just check all my queries, copy them, hop over to Excel, go to the data tab here, open the query editor, and just...
Sorry, are you sharing your screen? Because it's not sharing.
Sorry. So what I did was... I just copied all my queries from just what I did was I checked all the queries here. Control A, Control C, copied all the queries. Two clicks. Went over to Excel, Control V. I have all the queries over in Excel, and can then work and do all the things in Excel instead if I think that it would give me any advantage, or vice versa. Yeah. So,
and you can do that with data flows now as well, right? You can copy and paste queries
into data flow
that way. Are there any challenges with doing that with all the complexity that you've got in Power Query? Are there some things that are still not supported in
a Power BI? Yeah, but it has improved a lot. I think there's still some connectors that are not there.
Right.
And but it has definitely improved a lot. There are some glitches still. For example, if you do this, but I don't go into the details here, but yeah.
Okay, sure. Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's a good note for everyone, actually. I think data flow is a really good place to create these queries, because then they could be reused everywhere. You're using the Power BI service, you're using, you know, the Power BI service to run all these things on a schedule. And, you know, it's storing the data in Data Lake. So it's almost building, you know, a little referenceable architecture. And if you link your workspaces to an external Data Lake storage account, you get the outputs of those data flows. So those clean conform data in a data lake that other people can access, and you can mount as another data flow and read only in another workspace. So I really like the idea of data flows and CDM and all of that as well. So I'm, you know, I think that's a really good place to take it to next level as well. Great. Yep. All right. Well, thanks so much, Imke. That was really great. There was a lot of content there, and yeah, I think we definitely need to have you back and show maybe the Monte Carlo stuff as well. That'll be great.
Happy to do so.
Okay. Well, so, thanks everyone who's on the line, and
thanks for having me. And
Christmas and New Year's, if we don't speak before. Yes.
Have a good Christmas, everyone.
And see you in the new year. Hopefully, 2021's a good year. All right. Thanks. Speak soon.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks. Bye. Bye.